Behind the glitz and glamour, there's a dark underbelly to K-pop. Let's talk about it. K-pop is now a genre of music. Since when was pop music from a particular country labeled as a country pop? We would be seeing a lot of English pop, American pop, Chinese pop if that was the case. But aside from assigning a language or origin as a genre of music, completely disregarding the fact that not all music from Korea is pop, but is frequently labeled as such, or the fact that any pop music from any other country is labeled as anything other than pop, K-pop has serious societal impacts that don't get enough scrutiny. In 2019 alone, we've seen so many scandals surrounding the pop stars from Korea, as well as other gross foul play from other members of the industry, from drug and sex scandals to forced prostitution, sexual assaults, and of course, suicides. Sorry if I can't pronounce this, but Cha Hin-ha, Ku Hara, Chao Jin-ru, and who knows how many other less known K-pop stars committed suicide. Sadly, this isn't even a rare occurrence in the industry, with the Korean pop industry throwing tragedy after tragedy year after year. So why does this happen so often in the Korean pop industry? It boils down to the culture of K-pop and to some extent the sexist, unequal opportunity culture of Korea. Despite being quite advanced in terms of internet liberty, Korea remains stagnant, even backwards when it comes to gender equality and gender roles in society. The men continue to dominate the white-collar jobs and women are still mostly expected to be housewives. There is inherent chauvinism, which means that women are not given much opportunity, if at all, to empower themselves. It's a society dominated by men. You can spot this kind of culture in other countries too, prevalent in Asia where women expect all manners of chivalry, from paying for everything on dates to being the breadwinner when starting a family. This of course comes with a caveat for the women as they are essentially expected to be full-time housewives and essentially act as sexual objects. Women in K-pop are treated no different. It might appear that they have some semblance of liberty and self-respect, but the reality is most women have had to do is unspeakable things to get their foot in the door, where competition is excessively high and opportunities very few. At the heart of many of the scandals, which appear not just in 2019 or 2020 or even now, but all the years before, are the reports of women who are paid to sleep with rich and powerful businessmen with significant influence in the industry. It doesn't help, nor is it a surprise then, that idols are banned from having relationships of their own. For not the potential damage it might do to their popularity with the opposite sex, but the value of being chaste and exclusive as sex objects to the higher-ups and potential business investment. One example most recently is Yi Jong-han, a former member of the group Big Bang who has been on trial over allegations of paying prostitutes for foreign businessmen to attract investment to his own business. Using sex as a means to climb the ladder isn't a phenomenon exclusive to Korea and its pop industry. It's considered the dark side of business in nearly all industries and societies with androcentric tendencies. K-pop is extremely saturated and highly lucrative. The allure of becoming a star has a much higher pull in Korea than anywhere else in the world. It's true that some early pop music from Korea was highly innovative and unique, even ahead of its time. This early advantage was abused by the record companies and turned into an industry where everything from the idols themselves to the music are all artificially managed to drive industry forward and capture the attention of as many young people as possible. Think of early successful influencers on other social media platforms opening up their own influencer agencies to manufacture even more influencers. The result of this is that the perceived barrier to entry is much lower than it actually is and makes becoming a K-pop idol seem more possible. The continuous mass flux of trainees to the few successful record companies mean that the industry is very much saturated with idols. When the supply of potential idols far exceeds demand, the reality is that most people don't get to debut. They will spend most of their early teenage years as a trainee in the hopes of catching the attention of someone higher up. Since there is an abundance of trainee idols and each are more desperate than the next to succeed, a natural arms race occurs. Every measurable attribute are considered. Looks, personality, musical ability, voice, dancing ability are all aspects an idol must excel at. This also explains why the plastic surgery industry in Korea is booming. In reality, much like the situation with university degrees and jobs, the idol industry is full of talented, good-looking, musically inclined, vocally gifted, dancing maestros. Making the cut is almost a game of chance. So women feel pressured to offer something extra in addition to all their other qualities, and that usually boils down to sexual services and favors with decision makers. Astonishingly, but perhaps not, it's the same with the guys too. K-pop is highly centralized and controlled at every level. Since the TV networks and record companies are all in cahoots with each other, an idol or group opportunity to make it big depends a lot on the opportunities to have a stage to perform and get attention through the traditional media channels. Few companies at the top dominate most of the airtime and thus the market is considered an oligarchy. When few companies collude together to keep their dominant position in the market, it makes it very difficult for competitors to enter the market. Furthermore, the intense competition and high turnover of idol or groups mean that the members of those groups have little input into the music they sing and perform. The saddest part of the industry is that almost all of the music produced in the K-pop industry come from the record companies themselves and not from the members of the group. They have a magical formula which has been honed over time and adapted to the needs of the market and do not need the artists to make meaningful contribution. Instead, they are treated like low-income paid actors. They are told what to sing and how to sing. Their dances are choreographed by someone who is not in the group. Their music is written by the same person or group who write and produce the music for all the other groups in the record company too. Their wardrobe is predetermined to optimize appearance with the music video and the general aesthetic the market expects to see. In essence, nothing about a K-pop group is organically created by the members of the group. It is all manufactured. So what does this mean for the industry? One, it means that we get endless amount of generic sounding music which are difficult to differentiate. Second, it means that diversity in the industry is decided by a few powerful people. And third, it means that the idols have little empowerment to express their unique artistry and talents. The more attention we give the manufactured idol groups, the more we empower the K-pop industry and its cronies. So it's time to think about whether we want that or not. So what are your thoughts? Who's your favorite K-pop artist? If you like this video, hit that like button, consider subscribing. I talk about money and everything related to it, so don't miss out. And as always, take care of your money.